haven't done much actually. Sorry, I gave a really big CV. Right. Am I audible to everyone here? Should be, right? Okay. So today I'll be talking about, giving a short overview about an important subgroup of hemato-oncology called as this myeloproliferative neoplasms. Nowadays, when I say hardcore hemato-oncology, it looks more out of general physicians, bracket. So just to give you a deja vu about some cases which you would have seen in your general medical practice itself, I will start with some original case discussions and then move on to what is myeloproliferative neoplasm and things like that. So this guy, say 2 months back I met this fellow. He was apparently normal according to him. He did a general master health checkup in our hospital. And many times our patients, you know, they will have some problem and then only they go for a master health checkup. They never say overtly they are doing it for a prophylaxis. They want the doctor to find out what the health problem they are having. So this fellow was having some vague symptoms as per the MSC physician's letter. And as a routine master health checkup, somebody did a CBC and a peripheral smear in this fellow. The pathologist rang me saying that sir, peripheral smear has come to us but it's looking like a bone marrow. So what I should do now? So this is the first case. Second case here, a neurologist will be knowing, he is sitting out here. Recently we had a middle-aged male who presented to a neurostroke emergency with acute onset hemiplegia. As a part of the hemiplegia, he was a non-diabetic, not a known hypertensive previously. We did all the routine investigations. And the neurologist, he called me saying that the hemoglobin has turned out to be 22 grams. So come and have a look over it, patient. This is the second case I did this session. And the third one, again somebody who is on a regular checkup, sorry sir. Somebody who is on a regular master checkup, old lady, I mean a retired person, 62 years. She does it annually. This time she, last time it was all fine. So this time she has got this complaint of some night sores, unintentional weight loss was there for this lady. And for the past 6 months or so, some physician here and there have been treating her with some kind of, it looks like an iron deficiency, so given a lot of iron supplements for this lady. So this was the picture, and as you see here, only hemoglobin was 9 and rest of the WBC etc. are all normal. One thing which prompted the MSC physician, the master checkup physician to send to me was, ultrasound wise there was splenomegaly evident in this person, which was not there in the last year's checkup. So with the background of these three cases, I will discuss something about this myeloproliferative neoplasms. When I talk about hematology of blood, the beauty of this blood system is, this is one system where nothing is permanent. As you all know, all blood cells, the three series, RBCs, WBCs and platelets, all of them have got a limited lifespan. Just like gastroenterology, Dr. Pandyapur will be knowing, like the enteral mucosa, everyday things keep on changing. It's a very dynamic system. And we, all of us know that the factory of all these blood cells is going to be our bone marrow. If you look into this bone marrow, hardly there are only two cells. This is a stem cell which I won't be talking much in detail now. But apart coming away from the stem cells, there are two progenitors. One is called as a lymphoid, which produces at the end of the day the lymphocytes. The other one is called as a myeloid, which actually if you see here in this picture, it produces all cells that we know in blood system except lymphocytes. So when I say at an MBBS level, when I say myeloid, we always equate it to WBCs alone. Unfortunately, physiology is not like that. To be more frank, in blood, everything is myeloid except lymphocytes. So when I use the term myeloproliferative neoplasm, it means not only an increase in WBCs, increase in anything in the blood except your lymphocytes. So tomorrow somebody comes to you with a high hemoglobin, think of myeloproliferative disorder. Somebody comes to you with a high platelets, that also you have to think of, because all cells in our body, our blood system, is going to be a myeloid cell except your lymphocytes. So as we see here, this is what we are going to discuss today. Something going wrong with this. Suppose you see this immature cell, if it goes very high in our system, we call it as leukemias. Suppose if it is not going very high, but not normal also, we tend to get all the mature cells coming in a very high level in that patient. That is what is called as a myeloproliferative neoplasm. When I say myeloproliferative neoplasm, the immediate term that comes into all of our mind is something called as a CML, chronic myeloid leukemia. WHO is an organization which keeps on, giving new and new classifications again and again, just because hematology is one field over the last 10 to 15 years, lot of things, newer molecular markers have also come up. This is not the same hematology we are looking 15 years back. A lot of new drugs have also come up, which have really changed the way the patient or the patient's prognosis. That's why we are updating ourselves with more and more of classification schemes. This is one of the latest classifications, but if I want to make it simple for a non-hematologist, if I want to look into myeloproliferative neoplasms, I will classify something like this. I've got only two working diagnoses. Suppose a patient of acute myeloid leukemia comes to me, I want to know is it a M3 or a non-M3. M3 means some treatment, non-M3 means some other treatment. Rest are all total nonsense just to irritate the undergraduate and postgraduate students for that matter. On a clinic, I just want to know this thing alone. In this myeloproliferative neoplasm, I have got only two things for that matter. Tomorrow, somebody comes with any high blood count except lymphocytes. One test I want to always do is something called as a 922 translocation or a Philadelphia chromosome, which is nowadays called as a, the expansion of the gene is called as a BCR-ABL gene. So why is it important? Because all of us know in 1999, when we all thought that cancer can never be conquered by oral medications, there was a poster boy of cancer, oral cancer chemotherapy called as imatinib, that was introduced, which really changed the paradigm of our oncology practice. So just because of the fact that there is a drug available for this mutation, in all patients I want to know only one thing. Is that fellow BCR-ABL1 positive? I will term that fellow as CML and start him on some medications. I am not bothered about whether he is having a spleen, not having a spleen, whether the blood count, these are all classical textbook teaching. But if somebody comes, nowadays just because of the more what, we haven't conquered much about cancer from our side, but patients are more intelligent nowadays. They just come, they have regular checkups, sometimes CML gets picked up even before somebody develops a spleen. So it is not that, you can even encounter these people in a general clinical practice also coming to you with very vague symptoms earlier. So first thing what I will do is this test, a BCR-ABL test. If it is positive, call that fellow CML and start him on some medications. If it is negative, I got a big list of wastebasket diagnosis. I can give a lot of names as I prefer. If hemoglobin is high or it is polycythemia, if platelet is high or it is essential thrombocythemia, but many times it cannot make much difference. In last 3-4 years it wasn't important, but a newer drug called as ruxolitinib got introduced. After that, it makes sense to even differentiate these conditions. First condition I will talk about CM, which I already told you, 922 is a classical translocations. But is it important? Yes. If you ask me in general the word leukemia, which is the commonest leukemia you encounter in our country, I will say leave aside acute, chronic, all those suffixes. If you ask me what is the commonest leukemia, I will say CML is considered to be the commonest leukemia which we encounter in our general practice or in India for that matter. And the uniqueness of our Indian patients is, Western data says a lot of patients come in the 5th and 6th decade. But unfortunately, most of our, not most of, the majority of our Indian patients, they present early. This is common to any other disease also for that matter. Our epidemiology is totally different. So in the younger patient also, somewhere in the 3rd or 4th decade also, we have started seeing this CML cases. So whenever somebody comes in, how your patients can present to you? Suppose, it's totally vague for that matter. First is, a very classical presentation is a big spleen, which nowadays we don't see much. Rest everything is like fatigue, cachexia, pruritus, night sweats. Most of them are vague symptoms. Nothing specific. Even if you think a bit more, many of us will have all these symptoms. So that doesn't mean we have, but still, these are all the symptoms how the patient may present to you with CML. So sometimes pain and due to splenic infarcts, sometimes severe myalgias, etc. These are all the non-specific symptoms. So initially we used to say all the symptomatic CMLs. Nowadays, even because of all the health checkups and other things, we start having asymptomatic CMLs also. Nothing there, patient just comes in. We do some tests, we find out that at least 10% of cases in my practice also, I get the case referral from pastoral checkup itself for that matter. So when I say CML, the first suspicion comes to me from the CBC, that is complete blood counts only. A very high WBC or whatever is seen. For all, the pathologist gives a big wrap of all reports, etc., etc. But for me as a clinician treating the patient of CML, I'm interested in only three cells. I want to know what is the blast count in the periphery. I want to know the another important cell, which is a normal cell, which gets increased in CML, which is basophil. What is the percentage of basophil? And what happens to the platelets? This will help me in categorizing the patient. Because the next question the patient is going to ask me is, in what stage I am? To answer this, I want to know about these three details very meticulously. If I'm not confident in my pathologist, I will have a personal look myself before talking to the patient for that matter. Next is, so this is for an interest, I want a recent case whom we got. This fellow's WBC count was around 2 lakhs. You see here, this Buffy code is something like 1/3 of the total blood itself. World and literature, if you go to the history of medicine, people used to think this as pus in the blood itself. That's what they were right actually. Because pus only, the WBC is increasing in the blood, creating a situation like this. So, these are all the phases in an untreated case. Nowadays, none of the CML cases go untreated, but if at all in a situation somebody gets untreated, is untreated, Then they go to the accelerator phase. Just before death, they go to a crisis called as a blast crisis. So what I normally do is, nowadays we have got away with doing a bone marrow aspiration for CML. That's not needed. If I want to classically proceed, I have to do a bone marrow aspiration. I have to do a cytogenetics to check the 922 translocation. Then I can do this fluorescence in situ hybridization, and finally this RT-PCRs. But nowadays what we do is, directly if I have a suspicion of a myeloid proliferation, because it's easier test, more compliant test to the patient also, I directly do a peripheral blood RT-PCR for BCR review. But still, if I have a doubt that the fellow is progressing or something, it's better I do a bone marrow, especially to document the level of fibrosis and things like that. So whenever I do a bone marrow, being a painful test, I never want the test to be repeated again and again in the patient. So if I'm doing a procedure, it's better I take all the samples which I feel may be needed for prognosticating and treating the patient in a single go. Maybe samples like biopsy, flow, cytogenetics, any bone marrow for them. It's better to take all the samples, look at the morphology. If needed, send the sample or process it further, otherwise throw off the sample. This is what we routinely do. So after diagnosing, yeah. CML, if you ask me, if I'm presenting in the same forum, say 15 years back, I will say that the only treatment of CML is give a chemotherapy and do an allogeneic bone marrow transplantation. But as I said, 1999 or 2000, they have made a big difference with the introduction of something called as tyrosine kinase inhibitors or imatinib. What this imatinib actually does is, normally this is a protein which is a nonsense protein in CML, creating all the issues. This works by some ATP mechanisms. Imatinib is basically a small molecule which goes and blocks the ATP binding site of this protein. Why I'm showing you this picture is, imatinib is not a cure for your CML. It temporarily blocks this BCR-ABL protein, so the patient is in remission. Yeah, he is able to go on well. From 1999, I have the data up to 2017. There are at least 70-80% of patients who are doing very well with imatinib, but unfortunately, if I want to stop it, then there is a possibility that this BCR-ABL can come back again. But at least I have a drug which, just like diabetes, though I will not be able to cure, but at least I will be able to keep it in control and make the patient live a normal life. But still there are patients who may not respond to this drug and they go to the next level of management. So imatinib is the first drug. So when people are not responding, lot of drugs are coming. This is like, how can I say, this creates a lot of confusion to the treating clinician also. This is like catching an auto in Vadapalli bus stand. 15 years back, if I call for an auto, it's very hard I find a single auto now, for the rate what I am saying. But now today we have the app, we get five cabs coming to us, and we don't know which one to choose. Same thing is happening with this CML also. Where initially I had only one drug called imatinib. Now I have lot of drugs, 5 or 6 drugs, of which 3 is available in our country itself and at a very cheaper rate also. But till not yet, as a clinician, most of us, we prefer to start the patient on imatinib. If there is a failure, I go to all the second line drugs like Tasigna, Nilotinib, Dasatinib or whatever. So there are some people who may not respond to anything. For them also, I prefer doing allogeneic bone marrow transplantation, especially when a CML comes in pediatrics. Very rare, but still, less than 18, 20 years if a CML comes, I am looking at a longer life again. I don't have the data more than 18 years. It's better to go off with an allogeneic bone marrow transplant rather than wasting time with the tyrosine kinase inhibitor. But as a bridging or a preface, we can always use it. So that's about CML. Next, we have finished with WBCs. Now we'll see what happens if somebody comes to you with a high hemoglobin and somebody comes to you with a high platelets. High hemoglobin is called as a cancer of RBCs, is called as polycythemia vera. Olden days, our WHO used to say somebody having 18.5 or 16.5, that is males 18.5 grams and females 16.5 grams, was considered to be suspicious of polycythemia. I don't know what made them to reduce this value. In 2016 data, it says anybody more than 16.5, you think of, I'm not confirming anything, you think of it. But if you ask me what is the commonest, if I see 10 cases in my OPD with more than 16.5 in our country, 9 will be some other secondary reason. They will be smoking, especially in a climate like this with heavy heat going more than 40 degrees. Dehydration itself may be a reason for a patient having a higher hemoglobin. So I have to ask for history of smoking, alcohol, dehydration. Whenever you are dealing with these ECHS and ex-servicemen people, they may be posted in some hilly areas. Coming back to the place, they still have the higher hemoglobin due to the erythropoietin drive. So all these secondary reasons I have to rule out. If nothing is fitting in, I will think of polycythemia. Here I have to do something called as a JAK2 mutation, compulsory to prove. But if you ask me, sometimes patients do come to us. The case what I showed you, they end up in a stroke emergency or a cardiac emergency with the MI or a stroke, and then we find out polycythemia also. Because Westerners, when the hemoglobin goes high, it shows up on the screen. But for a Dravidian skin like me, it is very tough. If my hemoglobin is going to be 19 or 20 also, we may not be showing up on our skin. So we have to, many times it's a retrospective diagnosis rather than a prospective kind of a thing. So whenever I say, suppose you consider a country as a whole, iron deficiency is a major medical problem in our government. Has been a big time failure in controlling iron deficiency, because iodine was white in color, salt is white in color, we are very good in fortifying iodine. But iron is black in color. If I start fortifying iron in everything, we end up with all black sambars and black idlis, which none of us want to eat. So at the end of the day, our country still suffers a very high iron deficiency thing. If iron deficiency is a major problem, these fellows are happy with a hemoglobin of 18 and 19. Why the hell I should pick up these fellows and treat them unnecessarily? Just because of the macrovascular complications, especially some thrombotic complications which can occur, because our blood tubes are not skewed to carry more than 16 or 17 grams of hemoglobin. So what to do? It is a very easily accessible answer. My problem is physical size of RBC. Take the RBC out of it, that's called as phlebotomy. And it's not called as blood donation. Please don't donate it to anybody else, because peripheral blood will have stem cells. It is like donating that stem cell to somebody else, it is donating the disease itself. So this is not called as blood donation, this is called as phlebotomy. Here is the only condition where the blood bank will charge for your blood donation, because that bag is not going to be used. That is the reason many of the patients never come back to us. I say go and donate without explaining much. You will go and see that somebody is charging for the donation, he never turns up to me again. So in those situations, what I use is, I use a non-specific cytoreductor called as hydroxyurea, so that I can space the donations or phlebotomies a bit higher. Nowadays, if somebody is not responding properly, you can even use this next generation drug called as ruxolitinib, but it's a bit costlier for a condition like polycythemia, but still if needed, we may use it if they are progressing. The next is what happens when platelets become more. The normal platelet count is up to 4 lakhs. Somebody more than 4.5 lakhs in the country, if you are seeing in the OPD, first thing I will always suspect is that fellow an iron deficient fellow? Because iron deficiency is the commonest cause of secondary thrombocytosis. Iron, what happens? Erythropoietin increases. You don't know what to do because there is no iron. It goes and stimulates the thrombocytin receptors to increase platelets. So tomorrow, if you see a higher platelet, look at the hemoglobin first. If that is low, that is the reason for your high platelets. If not, look for any infection. Virals can come make the platelets drop. There are many bacterial infections because there is an acute phase reactor, if we go high. Next, look for any blood loss. It may be iatrogenic or a non-iatrogenic blood loss. Next, look for CML. If CML is also not there, think of a condition called as essential thrombocythemia, which is just a diagnosis of exclusion. It is not a common condition at all. Here, nothing much to do. Let platelets be there at 7 lakhs, 8 lakhs. What is going to happen? Maximum, they live for 4 to 5 days. I don't want to remove these platelets, but I am very worried about the function of the platelets. So I want to block the function of the platelets by giving a drug called a simple aspirin or clopidogrel. That's more than enough. And most of these patients will have a normal lifespan and a normal life instead of having an essential thrombocythemia. So the last in the series will be, what happens when the fibrosis increases? This condition is called as myelofibrosis. So in this condition, I'm not discussing much further. Many of the patients again present with very vague symptoms and with a bit of high spleen. When you see anemia is considered to be the major symptom, and I'm not going into much details. Here, what I want to just stress upon one point is there's something called as JAK2 mutation, which initial stages, if you ask me what to do for myelofibrosis, the only treatment I will say is give some chemotherapy and get on with an allogeneic bone marrow transplant. But this JAK2 inhibitor called as ruxolitinib nowadays has made a major difference in the treatment, at least reducing the symptom burden so that the patient finds some time so that he can get on to an allogeneic bone marrow transplant. Since I'm talking about transplant again and again, many people may not be directly involved in transplants. In just 1 minute, I will try to explain a different way what I do in my office or whatever. What is all about a bone marrow transplantation? I'm an MD in medicine, so I don't do any surgical procedures. That's the one thing with the patient is always asking me, am I going to do a surgery? This is not a surgery. This is like doing agriculture, rosayamandraman basically. What we do in agriculture, whenever you have some weeds or unnecessary plants growing, which is my leukemia or some blood cancer, what I have to do, give some pesticides or something to kill off the weeds. That is what I do by giving chemotherapy or radiotherapy or whatever. After taking out the weeds, I cannot go and immediately put in the new soils. So what I have to do, I have to get the soil ready. I have to get the soil kind of conditioned to take up the new seeds. That is what is called as a conditioned regimen or whatever. This conditioned regimen will have lot of some chemotherapies, etc., etc. After getting this conditioned regimen, I will get the good seeds or the stem cells from the donor. Donor can be anybody. Nowadays, we can do transplants in half match donors. We don't want a 10 by 10 full match donor. That's called haploidentical transplants. So a father, mother, son, daughter, anybody can be a donor. We don't have to go behind donors. And they are also not going to lose anything. No bone marrow, nothing done. It is just a peripheral blood procedure. We are going to do the transplant. After seeding the seeds, we tend to get all the blood cells back, which is called as engraftment. So this is about some myeloproliferative. I do understand all hematology is always Greek and Latin. But one point I just want to stress here is, any increase in blood cell except your lymphocytes and abnormal blast, think of myeloproliferative illness. As a rule of thumb, if you want to proceed further, do a test called as BCR-ABL, which is very cheaper nowadays, 6,000-7,000 rupees it cost in all the labs. If that is positive, refer to a hematologist to start an imatinib. If that is negative, do all those JAK2, etc., etc. Now, better refer to some other so that they can carry it on further. So this is all about myeloproliferative neoplasm. Thank you for giving me this opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you very much for a very electrifying lecture. Please give me a very big hand first. Now I request Professor Dr. Chandrasekhar to hand over a certificate of appreciation. After that, any questions, please go ahead, sir.
After
explain
it to me.
Yes,
sir.
Yes, sir. That's normally platelets get destroyed in spleen. Especially in conditions like say ITP and all, where spleen may not be perfect, but still then, but it will settle. I'm not worried if it goes up to 7-8 lakhs, I start an aspirin or something. I wait for it to settle down. Some patients it takes 6 to